Yeah, good morning once again, people. And hope you all are fine and things around you are fine. The rate at which the pandemic is once again spreading in a new variant is really significantly, I would say, bothering. Okay, you'll see that the rate at which it is happening all around us, and every now and then we get to know about someone very near to us being infected, and then we start thinking about the symptoms, and every time we have some itch in our throats, we feel that well, could it be me, the next one as such. So the best thing is to keep your mouth and nose covered during times where you are in a larger crowd, and of course basically maintain a distance of at least 6 feet from the next person as such. Okay, and take utmost care and see that your immunity stays strong is a contemporary issue that I would rather say as far as human geography is concerned. We have been speaking about or around, I would say, the syllabus yesterday. I'll just post up the syllabus once again. Yeah, so we did speak about all these things yesterday, and the introduction to human geography that we are going to fall into, and then the population and the various theories of distribution of population, and how there has been a growth and distribution of population throughout the world is the next thing that would follow. Interestingly, as I always feel that it's so dynamic a subject that every now and then you think about the subject in a different mood, you get a different interpretation. In the sense that when we speak about geography generally, okay, we always label geography as the mother of all sciences. The reason being that the first thing that human beings started looking for and studying around is something that we learn in geography, isn't it? He started looking for trees, he started looking for food, he started looking for water. Okay, so all of that is so much a integral part of physical geography. However, when we compare physical geography and human geography, there is a significant difference as far as the approaches is concerned. The study of human geography comparatively is seen to be much, much recent as compared to that of physical geography is an interesting point to note. Now, why is it and when is it that man started thinking about the fact that he should be studying himself as well, his impact, and of course the impact of the nature on him? You see that this is a very recent phenomenon. And what is this phenomenon related to? This is more or less, I would say, related to the Industrial Revolution. What is it that happened in the Industrial Revolution that we were able to think about and start of fact? One of the things that industry out is the control method. I'm going to start this in graphication model, but just to give you a peripheral view of how and when and how far have we been studying cells? That was one thing. The death rates fell down, and because of this, population numbers started growing up. Another product of the Industrial Revolution was transportation, and transportation not only within a particular area, across boundaries, across continents, and thus you'll see that when Europeans traveled to different parts of the world, they came across people who were differently textured, their eye shapes were different, their hair, the heights were different, and so on and so forth. Their languages were different. So they built a need of regionalizing all these things. So gradually, you see that human geography started impacting. And of course, to dominate in the sense of history, I would rather say, to go around colonization, a study of all these things was very necessary for the Europeans. As a consequence, you'll see much of the understanding about human beings, the populations, etc., started after the Industrial Revolution. We did not bother that much. Okay, basically because I would say till the 14th, 15th century, the population of the world was not much, one. And secondly, that they were not in contact with each other. Those who were in contact of each other, these contacts were on the basis of core trade. So for example, we speak about Indian merchants traveling to the Mediterranean Sea and having trades there. Okay, but you'll see that beyond this, there were not much contacts. You'll see, we don't have reports of Indian merchants traveling to Australia. We don't have reports of Indian merchants traveling to South America. We don't have, say records of Indians and Indian merchants traveling to North America. Okay, so it was basically the continuous expanse of the European, Asian, and African continent which is called as the Old World. This is called as the Old World. Sorry, Old World includes of Europe, Asia, and Africa. And what is Africa? And what comes in the New World? You'll see that it is those lands which were discovered as a product of colonization, or I would say industrialization. This includes North America, this includes South America, and this includes Australia. Okay, so this part of the world remained secluded, isolated. I wouldn't say it was not inhabited as such, but it remained secluded, and most of the activity used to happen within this. Another thing that we can easily note of is that as I said yesterday also, that when history is written, it is written in the sense of the person who wants to get the history written as such. Say, for example, even in case of Indian history, it could be the Mughals and it could be the kings and emperors before that also. the kings and these emperors are normally portrayed as very, very role modeling, portraying individuals as such. Now, how is it possible that every other king has very good behavior and that his administration was perfect and so on and so forth? Isn't it that they did not, or does it mean that they did not feel they did not come across any failures? Is it that they did not have problems with regards to their own subjects? Is it not that they did not have problems with regards natural disasters, etc.? But you'll see that because they used to get history written as such, okay, and the person was writing the penning the history, we would put it in that way, the person was penning the history was at the patronage of that particular dynasty or that particular king as such, they would obviously glorify that particular period, okay, of that particular king as such. Okay, that certainly does not mean that it did not they did not have adverse times. Had they not had adverse times, the same dynasty would have been there till today also. Obviously, the phasing out of one dynasty and the the evolution of some other dynasty is because of the fact that there could have been some problems with those respective dynasties. So similarly, when we speak about the Old World, you'll see that a lot of these things we speak about is the trade between the Indian traders and the countries around the Mediterranean, and particular to the north of Mediterranean, the Greeks and the Romans. And you'll see that we don't have much mention about countries which are beyond that. And we saw that. And of course, we are going to repeat it today also, that temperatures kept these areas from being inhabited for a significant period of time. Not that we did not have populations then, but the populations were very, very... they were very low in number, and it was an evolutionary process of that sect of population which had adjusted itself to that particular area. Okay, and that no foreigners could do that. How did the foreigners started occupying this? When you had proper shelter, and of course you could change your lifestyles as per the temperature. If it got cold, you could have warm clothes. If you get warm, you could have clothes of cotton, and so on and so forth. This reminds me that I was just watching a small information on Facebook about a particular, I forgot to pin it, otherwise I would have shown it here as well, that there is this particular tribe somewhere in South Sudan. There is this particular tribe which is an exclusive tribe of that particular place. And you'll see that kids of 18, 19, and 20 years are 6.5 feet and beyond that. And the whole of the tribe, okay, whole of the tribe is 6 feet. Even the girls in that particular tribe are 6 feet. And of course, the clip, it was being recorded by some European. He himself was some 5'7", 5'8", and he looked so dwarfed in front of these people. And all of these were young kids, of course. And so you'll see that there are some genetics, and these genes evolve as long as they get strengthened if you are going to stay in a particular type of environment for a longer period of time. The genes adjust to the environment, and that's why we may feel cold in Leh and Ladakh, but you'll see that the lama staying there will not feel the cold as such. Okay. And in fact, you'll see that if you go to places like Bhutan, if you go to places like Tawang in Arunachal Pradesh, etc., I have experienced that personally, and that's why I could share this with you, that I was in Arunachal Pradesh for a conference, and then I thought of flying to Tawang for as I traveled so long a distance. I was with my friend, and we went to Tawang to have a short picnic as such. And that very night, I got a very stuffy feeling, as if I was not able to breathe as such. And immediately my friend opened up the windows of the hotel room, and after normalizing down, I took some deep breaths, and after that I normalized, and we thought about the fact that why did this happen. Okay, that happened basically because the elevation of Tawang is around more than 3000 meters above mean sea level, and of course I had traveled there from Pune, which is what, 650 meters above mean sea level. Even if you say I was traveling there from Arunachal Pradesh, where I was attending the lowlands of Arunachal Pradesh, that was not more than a few hundred meters, and suddenly I had taken a height of a few thousand meters. Okay, and that choked me for some time, particularly during the night time. So you'll see that these adjustments, okay, and that is what makes tribes and individuals and races different from each other. Okay, though we all call ourselves as Homo sapiens, within us, you'll see that we have different genes, and that's why you'll see that we are so much different from each other. Okay, regionally also. But coming back to the fact that not much is being written about, say the trade between Asia and Africa. Okay, possibly Africa was still significantly secluded. It did not have that much of prosperity to go into that much amount of trade with foreigners like that from China and that from India and so on and so forth. Okay, remember, there were times where India and China accounted for more than 50% of the world's trade. Again, when I say world's trade, it was, we are referring to the old world and not the new world otherwise. Okay, so we have stories about how silk traveled from China through what is called as the Silk Route into the Roman Empire, and how Indian traders used to go across the Arabian Sea to trade into the Mediterranean Sea also. So you have so many things. And of course, within Africa, you'll see that it's only the coastal areas which develop. So possibly it could be the natural difficulties that this again forms to be a very important part of human geography, as to when we study about Africa. Okay, I did mention that probably they were not that much prosperous, but the more important fact I would rather say is that if you look at the continent of Africa, it is full of so much of natural diversities, and these diversities are natural extremities as well, in the sense, towards the north of Africa you have one of the largest deserts, that's called as the Saharan Desert, and towards the southern part you have the Kalahari Desert. Between the Sahara Desert and between the Sahara and the Kalahari Desert, you have the equatorial forests of the Congo, etc. Then you have the Rift Valley. So there is such of uniqueness of the physical diversity along the continent of Africa that possibly it did not favor that much of human settlement for a significant period of time. Even today, you will see that Africa as a continent is not favored. It may have a lot of resources, and it is these resources which are now attracting investors from different parts of the world into Africa. But as far as human settlements are concerned, there are two areas. Okay, we should be doing this in population. We'll repeat this in population also. But then two areas which with a significantly high density of population, when you compare it to the rest of Africa as such, are is the Nile Delta towards the north, which is, of course, and mind you, though the Nile is 6,500 kilometers long, the course of the Nile does not have very high population settlements along the banks of the river. It's only towards the mouth of the Nile Delta, on which survived the Egyptian civilization, which has a very high density of population, Egypt. And then you come down south, and that's South Africa, which again, of course, it's not as high densely populated as Egypt, but then in South Africa, you have a significant amount of population density. And of course, it is a multiracial, and it is multidimensional. You have Europeans, you have Asians, and you have the local Africans also, all making a very excellent blend of different populations within South Africa. You'll see that not many countries other than these are normally in discussion as far as the continent of Africa is concerned. Then Africa. If you refer to the history of it, when you go to the history, Africa comes into picture when colonization was at its peak, in the sense that it was the Europeans who were traveling to African shores, and they were actually bringing out a lot of spices and fruits, tropical fruits. And of course, you have the whole chapter in history which is called a slave trade. So it's that unfortunate part of history wherein Africa seems to be more talked of. Otherwise, you'd see that not much of discussions you'll find in history as far as the old world is concerned. And that's in fact one of the reasons that we should be studying all these aspects also. And then from population, we will move into settlements, and of course, how the population and settlements materializes into economic geography, the two major parts of that being agriculture and, of course, industry. We are going to go into the details of that at some point of time. Before we go ahead with this, I think you might remember this. We have done this earlier, but then we have to today do it with a specific reference to human geography, okay, which would include economic geography also. But before we do that, I would come out of this for some time, and we would go back to presenting two clips. One which we saw yesterday, and that's the second part of this, wherein we had an ice age around 25,000 years ago.
Twenty thousand years ago, the world suffered in the depths of the last ice age. For several thousand years, global average temperatures stayed 15 degrees Fahrenheit, that's about 8 degrees Celsius, below what they are today. And mile-thick glaciers covered much of North America, Europe, and Asia. Outside the ice-covered regions, it was so dry that survival became difficult in most areas. Some areas where people had been living became inhospitable. And in some other places, new barriers of ice or desert separated groups of people. But against all odds, some people found ways to survive in severe conditions, as far north as Siberia, The Ice Age not only created barriers, it also created bridges. With so much water locked up in ice, sea levels dropped, exposing land and connecting Siberia and Alaska. A few people in Siberia took advantage of this bridge, moving into present-day Alaska and later down into other parts of North America. Maybe they followed migrating herds of big game. Or maybe they traveled in small boats down the Pacific coast. Or maybe they did both. No matter how they got there, those people who did became the ancestors of today's Native Americans. In just a short time, humans from a small corner of Africa had populated all continents save Antarctica. And in their new homes, their languages began to differentiate, to form the precursors of today's languages. Some populations probably didn't survive the Ice Age, and those that did often became more isolated from other groups. Scattered around the world, these small populations became more linguistically, culturally, and genetically distinct from one another. How would cultural innovations help a few of these groups to expand dramatically over the next several thousand years?
Okay, that was one of it. And immediately after this, okay, what happens is that man goes into sedentary agriculture. And that's again a very interesting part that needs to be seen, because it's a follow-up of what happened after the ice ages receded, okay, and why we are where we are today. Okay, let's see that as well.
By 14,000 years ago, the Ice Age was winding down. As the ice melted, oceans rose and coastlines changed. Some environmental barriers between populations vanished, while elsewhere, new ones appeared. Temperatures and rainfall increased dramatically. And some areas became so rich in plants and animals that people no longer had to travel in search of food. Instead, people settled into more permanent villages based on foraging. By planting the seeds from wild grains near their homes, they could supplement their food supplies and stay in the same spot year round. Perhaps as they became more sedentary, they had more opportunities for other pursuits. In any case, populations grew, and pretty soon, growing families in these villages became less suited to the nomadic lifestyle. In some places, during droughts or harsh winters, local wild plants and animals could no longer support everyone. Independently and all over the world, people began making the same discovery, which would change human societies and the natural environment forever. They developed agriculture. It's not an obvious choice. Hunter-gatherers can provide food for their families by working only a few days a week. Farming, on the other hand, is hard work and a full-time job. But farming provided more food to feed larger populations consistently. Villagers began relying more and more on their gardens. As mutant varieties of wild grains occurred, these early agriculturalists chose the crops with larger seeds and grain ears that were easier to gather. People also domesticated docile local animals. Villages grew, especially in areas with fertile soil, and became cities. And settled people became more detached from the natural world. By 6,000 years ago, in Mesopotamia, there were cities with wealth, power, and a new social order. Whoever controlled grain supplies wielded power. And some people no longer had to find or produce their own food, but rather exchanged their services for dinner. Agricultural societies soon became the dominant way of life for people throughout the world. World populations exploded, creating more laborers to produce more crops. To feed more mouths, more land had to be cleared for farming. Sometimes, whole towns relocated when soils couldn't sustain repeated cultivation. And each year, people took their livestock farther and farther afield to graze. Groups who had been separated for thousands of years came in contact as they traveled in search of land, labor, and trade goods. New means of transportation brought distant cultures in contact. New families produced from these contacts blurred genetic distinctions within continents. And all around the world, migrating fathers encountered hunter-gatherers. In sub-Saharan Africa, for example, farmers spread east and south from present-day Cameroon around 5,000 years ago. Along the way, they met and absorbed many of the people whose ancestors had been living there for thousands of years. Some hunter-gatherers who lived next to farming communities took up farming themselves. But others followed game to areas unsuited for agriculture. By 1500 years ago, agriculture dominated most of sub-Saharan Africa. But the Kalahari Desert, too harsh for farming, remained the home of hunter-gatherers, who kept not only much of their lifestyle, but also their unique click languages. In most places throughout the world, however, agriculture triumphed. As the new farmers on each continent expanded and absorbed other hunter-gatherer groups, genetic differences within continents began disappearing, setting the stage for the most recent chapter in our human story.
So that is one of the most easiest and the best of the explanations you could have as to how the whole thing happened around us and for that period. And of course, it brought back memories of, or rather, it brought back references of what I was referring to earlier, that the Fertile Crescent and, of course, areas near to that, that's particularly the Nile Delta, And these, you'll see that invariably when we speak about the history of farming, it starts from that particular pocket and the delta of the Euphrates, as it is called. But you'll also see that it did mention about once it gets infertile or it is exploited excessively, what exactly happens is that they have to migrate from one region to other. One of the reasons why the Euphrates is not that prosperous today could be that. And in fact, many of the anthropologists do argue, archaeologists also do argue, that one of the reasons why the cities of Mohenjo-daro and Harappa would have lost their importance is basically because they were a part of a very fertile tract, some related to the Indus, some related to the what is that river, Saraswati river, okay, the mythological Saraswati river. Some say it's the present Indus who has shifted its course westward, and because of that those areas became drier, and eventually the towns which we like Lothal and Mohenjo-daro and Harappa, etc., they went off the map of civilization, only to be unearthed during an archaeological expedition by a British archaeologist. So that also underlines the fact as to how and why we should be sustainable as far as our practices are concerned, because the rate at which, okay, I was mentioning this to my BSc students, because they are into a paper of climatology, and we are speaking about the composition and the structure of the atmosphere. We did this on a very fairly superficial scale in our first semester as such, but then when we speak about global warming, when we speak about carbon dioxide and the increase of the percentage of carbon dioxide, there are always arguments saying that isn't it that plants also give out carbon dioxide? Isn't it that you have so many natural volcanoes in different parts of the world, and don't they give out carbon dioxide as such? The answer to this is definitely yes, but you'll see that that is a part of the natural system. And because that is a part of a natural system and it has been sustained for millions of years, if not billions of years, as such, the whole system, the environmental system, adjusts to it over the period of time. However, exhaust of carbon dioxide, which has increased many, many times in the last 400 years, particularly after the Industrial Revolution, is something that is unnatural, and that is what human beings are contributing. And having said that, you'll see that the nature itself is so very confused with this unnatural growth of carbon dioxide that it's not able to adjust it at a natural proportion. And as a consequence, it so happens that it leads to a problem which we today study and know as global warming. So not that these gases were not there before, but they were there, but they were blended as a part of the whole system. The rate at which we are contributing these pollutants, I would rather say, why should we always blame carbon dioxide only, all these pollutants to the nature? The nature is not able to handle this at the pace at which nature goes. And as a consequence, we have these problems. And that's why the word sustainable, okay, we should extract resources at the pace at which nature is able to replace them, and they would be available for our future generations. If we don't do so, okay, we read this in various articles that many species of plants as well as animals are going extinct, and the rate at which they would go extinct would but naturally grow faster if we are not able to arrest our unfortunate practices that we are going ahead with on the surface of this planet. Okay, so all this becomes an important and essential part of understanding human geography before we start studying. Yes, human geography is going to be majorly what we are doing around today, and that's why contemporary issues happens to be a major part of your topic in the major syllabus. But then to understand what is happening around, we should obviously be linking ourselves to what may have been happening previously, and those memories which should help us to tackle problems if we have any around us. So that is why we need to have a brief knowledge about the history, and eventually we would be studying the present scenario, of course, divided into so many other divisions. Now, what are these divisions that we have been continuously speaking of? What should we be speaking all about these divisions? And these divisions are here. As far as these divisions are concerned, let me just pin it up so that you can see it on a larger scale. Yes. So when we speak about these divisions of the study, okay, yes, we have done this earlier also, but for the benefit of those students who joined in late or were not available when we did this, okay, this could just be a very fast discussion on what are the various branches of geography to start with. And you'll see that in this diagram, we tend to classify it into physical geography, human geography, and economic geography. I would prefer to put these together, okay, because economic geography is based on human geography. But then why has someone who has put up this this diagram on the net divided it into two? It could possibly be the biological part of humans and of course the commercial part of humans being separate. Maybe he, she wanted to study it separately. Okay, we will do it at our pleasure. Don't worry about that. We have done major parts of this. Major in the sense we have done geomorphology, the land part of it, the air part of the earth, and of course the water part of the earth very briefly. But in spite of the fact that we have done it very briefly, the connections that oceanography has, I did say about this when we were doing it as a part of our syllabus in the first semester, that we do it at a very fast pace, basically because the connections that it has with climatology and which it has with geomorphology already have been discussed. Okay, so we just hurried it up through oceanography. I believe we have given ample amount of time to understand those as well. But then the context of the matter today is more so to say, sorry, just let me keep this free for us. We are more concerned about this part of the whole scenario. And what should we take first? Of course, man comes first. So let us see what they have to speak about as far as human geography is concerned. So I will just enlarge it for us. And are we doing all of this in our syllabus? Possibly not. We are doing population geography. Yes, that's the second part. It's here. Okay, it's here. And we are going to do settlement geography. What does human geography also include? Yes, human geography includes human occupation of the earth. What we speak as population is otherwise population and settlement put together is basically the human occupation. Now, then the obvious question would be, what is the difference between calling it as human occupation and calling it as population and settlement? Let me remind you, population and settlement comes as a term, comes much, much later. Occupation is what we saw in these clips just a few moments ago. Okay, how small groups of people try to move from, say, their core area of comfort, and they try to move into other areas and try to settle down in these areas. Of course, they may have faced difficulties, but then how they sustain through those difficulties is what basically is meant by the fact of human occupation. How did human beings occupy the different parts of the earth? While doing this, again, the clip speaks about those aspects, and you can just go through it once again. Once I have, I will be posting it, the link of it, once I have uploaded it on the YouTube channel as such. The ethnic composition, okay, of different people, okay, then the process of evolution. How did people evolve biologically? How did people evolve culturally? How did people or populations evolve as a civilization? Okay, in this process, how have human beings adapted? How have human beings changed the environment? And on the other hand, how has the environment required human beings to change to its basic format, where it was not possible for human beings to absolutely change the environments around? But you'll see that human beings have adapted according to climates and environments. Say, for example, in the tropical regions, The agricultural practices are unique, and of course, the producers of these agricultural practices also are unique. Okay? You see that majority of the cereal crop production of the world comes from the tropical region. The wheat you speak about, the rice you speak about comes, and then as you move away, you have other cereals in the form of maize and so on and so forth. The drier parts, you have cereals like rye and bajra and jawar. So you'll see that this has come out. Today we learn it in the form of geography, but then let me tell you that these are lessons that human beings have learned over a long period of thousands of years of trial and error. Okay, they may have tried this crop, they may have tried that crop. Rains may have one particular year, the crop may have been fine, but the next year rains may not have been there. The same crop would have been a disaster next year. So all these combinations, okay, which we face with agriculture even today, may have been tried over a period of time. But let me tell you that in the present conditions, we are much, much, I would say, assured of the crop. Even if we have a famine in a particular area, you could move in crop stocks and food stocks from other areas, which may not have been the scenario when we are speaking about the period, say, 10,000 years ago, 15,000 years ago, when human beings were still occupying different parts of the earth. So that the basic things of human geography are understood in the initial topics. In the sense, it blends with anthropology to an extent that it studies the color of the hair, the texture of the hair, the thickness of the hair. You'll see that the thickness of the hair of people in Africa would be much thicker as compared to those in Asia. And as far as South Asians are concerned, their hair are going to be having a thicker diameter as compared to those of the Chinese people, case which who have a very smaller diameter. And having said this, let me tell you that when we compare it between males and females, let me also share with this with you that anthropologists say, I don't say this, anthropologists say that the thickness of the hair of females in human beings is less as compared to thickness in the sense the diameter is less as compared to your males as such. So possibly in a few thousand years down the line from now, women may not be left with hair at all, men would have some hair. But then possibly by that time, we have evolved into a fashion wherein getting bald would have been the major fashion of that particular point of time, say 5,000 years down the line, 10,000 years down the line, who knows what would happen at that period of time. Okay, so this is how people evolve. You see that when it comes to growing of particularly the male gender as such, growing of the beards and the mustaches as such, and then of course the style with which you keep your hair, you'll see that you'll see that you could compare it to the local conditions also, in the sense that the present fashion as far as keeping a beard and mustache is concerned, 10 years ago we did not have this fashion. How is it that it has suddenly come up? Okay, you'll see. And how is it that every other, okay, now fashion is something which comes out of someone who is to bring that particular fashion. Okay, so you'll see that if Virat Kohli is going to sport a beard, okay, you'll see that people who are going to like Virat Kohli are going to obviously start fashioning a beard as such. But then not many parents would agree with those youth to keep their beards as such. But then is there a condition which forces us into doing that? Yes. So you'll see that last year we had all the lockdown and all the shops, the beard shops were closed as such. And as a consequence, all of us were growing hair and beard and mustaches. And eventually when these things opened up, we fashioned them into different shapes and sizes. So that is how actually things move as far as how civilization progresses. So from that part of human geography, when the numbers grow, they settle down, we come to population geography. Why have these numbers grown? How have these numbers grown? Which are the areas in which the numbers have grown? Why is it that in some areas the numbers are not growing? Why is it that some areas of the planet have a significantly high number of old population? Why is it that you have death of small kids in a particular age group in particular areas? All of this is going to be called as population geography. This is called as demography. कि वी स्पीक अबाउट माइग्रेशन हाउ पीपल बिकॉज दैट्स एन इम्पॉर्टेंट पॉइंट ऑफ ह्यूमन एवोल्यूशन एंड ह्यूमन डेवलपमेंट वी सॉ दिस इन दैट क्लिप अगेन टू रिमाइंड यू ऑल दैट व्हेन पीपल ऑफ डिफरेंट जीन्स आर गोइंग टू कम and they are going to give birth to the newer generations, possibly that generation is going to be more adaptable to the changes that happen with the environment as such. So all this is done in population geography. We are not going to go into all that details, but mind you, what you see in front of you is basically what we do overall in population geography. Our syllabus has put population geography into one particular topic of your syllabus. So we are going to restrict ourselves to our discussion when it comes to population geography as such. And then cultural geography. Cultural geography is how a particular culture, okay, we speak about the Indian culture, we speak about the Chinese culture, we speak about the Roman culture, we speak about the Greek culture. Okay, what does culture basically mean? It's the average condition of a particular civilization. And a particular culture, so you'll see that the we more often refer to us as modern culture. Now, what is the modern culture doing? You'll see that the last point there, the impact of the environment of the on the patterns, on the culture, or rather, is this culture through its technology having a reverse impact on the environment? All this will be studied under cultural geography. And then you'll see that the population that we were speaking about and we are going to speak about as a separate topic needs to be settling down. We again saw some part of it in the clip as such. Now, how this settles down, where this settles down, whether it settles near to the river, whether it settles away from the river. Okay, we have to understand this. When population started to grow in higher proportions, in the sense we saw in that clip also, then we have to move out. Okay, we have to make adjustments. And we saw that how people went out of agriculture as a major activities, and when population had moved out of agriculture as a major activity, we call them these as urban areas. Of course, the definitions of urban areas will change in different areas, and of course, we're going to look into that when we speak about settlement geography. As opposed to urban areas, we're going to have people living in rural areas, rural tracts as such. And all this, the study of all this, okay, in fact, you'll see that the study of the archaeological study of Mohenjo-daro, Harappa, the remnants of these towns that we found could be an important part of settlement geography, but at that particular moment of time, so we call that as archaeological geography. And then the most important part of human geography, while we come towards the close of that, is political geography, how people organize together. Now, why do we have politics? Is basically, you'll see that we with such large a population, we have to take care that there is an ample amount of welfare of this population at an average level, and it should not be that some people are runaway rich people, and then you have some people who fall back as severely poor people. That should not be happening, and as a consequence, we need to have what we do is we are represented by a few people who form what is called as the government. Governments are going to be of different types. You could have a democratic government, you could have an autocratic government, you could have a communist government, you could have a socialist government, depending on the pattern of a governance that a particular population selects to rule itself by. Okay, and you'll see that you could have benefits and you could have flaws of each type of government, but at the present rate, throughout the world, you'll see that you have different types of government and you have blends of different types of government, some parts of this and some parts of that. You'll see that a few decades ago, China was supposed to be a hardcore communist government. It still happens to be a communist government, but you'll see that it has changed the face of communism to a bit of capitalism also. And that's why you see that it prospers as one of the major developing countries of the world, with a very high per capita income and with a very high FDI flows and so on and so forth. Does that mean that capitalist economies are fine? No. You'll see that capitalist economies could lead to a diversification between scales of economic growth, in the sense you could have, as I said, you could have runaways, rich people. We use the adjective as stinkingly rich people. On the other hand, you could have very poor people. So that is a flaw as far as capitalist governments are concerned. Each of these styles and fashions of government have their positives and negatives. as such. So that's as far as one part of human geography. When we go into, now this is more about human beings overall. Okay. Now, as far as the activities of human beings are concerned, that is more referred to when we speak about economic geography. We would be speaking about economic geography when we meet tomorrow in the morning. Now, before I close, I'll just stop this because I'm done with my lecture right now. So I will end the show here, and I will come back to this. Now, we are scheduled to have two sessions tomorrow. One of the session, I would like to have it as a regular lecture. And then one of them is where I would have a clip, which is around a documentary, which is around 50 minutes long. So we could watch that. Now, I want you to suggest me as to which of this is to be done at 7 o'clock and which of this is to be done at 9:30 in the morning. Okay, please let me know as to how we can go about. I would be engaging both the lectures for tomorrow. One would be the documentary, which we need to see as far as how man has grown. This is going to be a mixture of all those clips that we have been seeing. Okay, so let me know when we could be watching that early morning, or you want it at 9:30, or you want the lecture at 9:30, or you want it at 7 o'clock. So please let me know as to how this should be. We could, if you are not in a position right now, we could be discussing it in our WhatsApp group also. Let's discuss it there. For now, if you have any questions for me,